It seems like so long ago that I, in an act of total frustration, dismissed the game Visage. This was a title that was running on an overwhelming adrenaline, jettisoned into the horror spotlight by a visible influence, an influence that was continuing to reshape the genre as we knew it. In the wake of a particular playable teaser, horror gaming was changing in the 2010s, and few knew it better than the indie dev community. Everyone wanted a piece of that pie, and so many games were released to hop on that bandwagon, capturing anxious horror game fans' interests. Visage, along with Layers of Fear and Allison Road, was standing as one of PT's spiritual successors. This implicit passing of the torch really was a striking statement, and PT's delisting only stoked that torch's flames further, even through Visage's extensive development and eventual early access release. As you might already know, I said that Visage needed work, and I was saying that through exasperated sighs of disappointment. But after full release, I gave Visage one more shot. Maybe this was a redemption in the making, maybe all of those problems that irritated me were gone. Maybe Visage would be worth talking about again. I guess you know the answer now, yeah? Knowing my track record, I wouldn't be discussing this game without there being something of interest to talk about, and yeah, you'd figure correctly. Visage is a success. But it doesn't succeed through heart-wrenching terror or mind-bending confusion, but because it creates an irreplaceable entity that's always peering at you. As the hours stack and your journey through its world becomes all the more pressing, the house in Visage becomes the crucial element that ties every bit of its guts together. It's a gripping, frightening place, and one of the most impressive horror locations I've seen in a long time. I'll get right to it. Visage's house is a masterclass in horror solitude. It creates its world with such poignancy and laser precision, a well-versed representation of a life in self-destruction. What's immediately shown through the environmental storytelling is a collapse. Something that was once a haven for its initial cast has degraded into something else, an aftermath of the residence implosion. The kitchen is cluttered with scattered dishes and cups. The bright light and crackling static from the TV fills its room. The remnants of the main character's grim substance abuse pepper each chamber. Sure, there have been many games where you're exploring an empty house and looking around at items to solve some kind of mystery, but Visage's incredibly oppressive atmosphere really makes the player feel like an intruder upon a place of almost sacredness, like witnessing a ghost town where the inhabitants have long since disappeared. In this sense of solitude, Visage is a portrait of ruin that begs to be examined down to its smallest detail. As the player, we're scrounging around the scraps left behind, violating the silence that the game's story magnifies so clearly. But at the same time, in an act of strong narrative significance, we play as Dwayne, the man whose mental descent is illustrated throughout the game. While we experience different characters' stories throughout Visage in an anthological format of sorts, it is Dwayne's exploration of these stories that fully realizes him as a character, and that characterization ties into the environmental storytelling as well. Throughout the house, we're shown pictures of families showing the cost of the resident's dwindling mental state, along with bottles of pills, empty beer cans, and other examples of Dwayne's substance abuse. While we as players are built to feel intrusive and out of place throughout Visage's world, Dwayne is the opposite. He's tightly connected to the house, he's meant to show that familiarity. The game's striking efforts to balance these two priorities, the players and the characters, is incredibly impressive, never skimping on either to build a creepy, unsettling universe that feels both alien and welcoming at the same time. In PT, Kojima and Del Toro managed to do a lot with a single hallway, but one big trick was using the idea of a corridor to present a suffocating sense of weight. PT was intentionally claustrophobic, both in aesthetics and game objective, but its set pieces were difficult to forget. The pressure instigated on the player, trying to avoid scares while figuring out how to progress through its winding world, was a key element of that game, and that design direction is just as present in Visage. The concept of losing sanity and becoming more vulnerable to the creatures you see throughout the house isn't entirely original, but it creates a similar kind of pressure, something to frantically maintain and monitor as you explore. You can't overlook that if you want to survive. But in giving the player so much open rein over where to go, Visage manages to deviate from PT in noticeable ways, while still retaining the ambiance that made Konami's playable teaser so memorable. Most notably, there's its layout. The house in Visage, from a design standpoint, initially comes across as a maze. Hallways and corridors twist and wind, connecting rooms and creating shortcuts. A stairway you might never even traverse could lead you to familiar territory when used with the right item. The house's basement alone has so many pathways, signified by a thick darkness that continues to creep along the walls each time you descend the stairs. I won't deny that it's a confusing layout at first. Some areas are locked or sealed in certain contexts. Signature landmarks aren't as plentiful as you might think. All in all, I can't say it's the most intuitive of designs. In fact, that ramp and PT comparison tends to work to Visage's detriment here. A single hallway is naturally easier to navigate than an entire house, so making that jump has growing pains, no doubt. It's not going to click until you're a ways into Visage's campaign. But at the same time, this does feel like the next logical step of what PT was trying to accomplish, the results of adoring fans building upon its homely but terrifying concepts. While I can't say with any degree of certainty that this is what Silent Hills was going to be like, Visage's house is a natural evolution of PT's ideas, a way to turn that one hallway into a full labyrinth of fear. Because no matter how many times you explore it, there's something incredibly tense about the house in Visage. You're never sure what might appear around a corner or behind a door, even if there's no enemy around to speak of. Your anxiety could be absolutely clean, but you can still walk around the building with trepidation. It's incredible how the devs successfully channeled the eeriness of being alone, entangling it with the fear of an uninvited guest being in the house with you. In each chapter, figures walk the halls of Visage's main location, acting as fail-states. But it's those moments of silence in between that really let you revel in what SadSquare Studios have put together. The tension of peering around the corner alone is unbelievable. You have no clue what might appear, even several playthroughs in. And while the jump scare fail states aren't very compelling on their own, Visage manages to keep these at bay for the better parts of its campaign. Yes, you will succumb to the monster's surprise attacks, but the noticeable environmental tells and subdued audio cues do alleviate the problem a remarkable amount. There are so many other indie games that coast on these obvious impulse gauges, so it's appreciated that Visage's best moments are still able to shine through, the silence amongst the noise. Because that's where it really grabs you by the throat. Visage is a terrifyingly quiet game, one that uses its grounded environment to craft scares so calculated in their silence. Compared to so many other indie horror games, Visage's location is meant to make every step you take into something hesitant and nervous. The house is key to so many memorable moments of this game. You can't accomplish nearly as much without it. You see where I'm going with this, right? I'm not sure what pushed the developers in this direction, but Visage makes the strange decision of moving its level design beyond the house itself. There are many sequences, especially in the third chapter, where you're not in the house, but instead teleported to totally different locations that don't have as much overt connection with the main location itself. Sometimes you're pushed into a cemetery, a hospital, or even a giant industrial building, and while I understand the purpose to keep players guessing and unsettled by constantly shifting scenery, I feel this is a misguided direction. When the player is meant to embrace the environmental storytelling, fully internalize the house's structure, and revel in the oppressive atmosphere of a fallen home, Visage shines. The house stands as a multi-purpose mechanic that embeds itself so much into what makes this game what it is, on a narrative, aesthetic, and gameplay level. When it comes to bringing its form and function into harmony, the house in Visage breathes. I'm not necessarily dismissing this deviation, as there are some pretty fantastic scares and puzzles surrounding these other locations. At their best, they even craft character profiles for each arc, especially in the exceptional Chapter 2, Dolores' chapter, where the outside locations explain Dolores' fragile mental state in symbolic ways. And yeah, the environments still feel unsettling in atmosphere alone. They get by pretty far enough just by being so ambient and rich with tension. That being said, they're not as mechanically sound here. After spending so much time in Visage's house, wandering the halls and fearing what you might find, being hurled into another place that struggles to fully connect with that main location is jarring. It's such a missed opportunity, and at its worst can retroactively devalue much of the game's core appeal. For example, the limited house segments in Chapter 3 are a complete waste, wiping away the honed environmental storytelling and thick ambiance in favor of dull chase sequences that don't really contribute to any kind of artistic or narrative design goal. They're a bit tense, yeah, but they don't serve as clear a purpose beyond just having something to run from. Like I said, I'm not sure what happened here, why there was such a driving initiative to move away from such an important location, but Visage's greatest weakness is simply not realizing that importance. It damages what would otherwise be a full embrace of horror level design and a textbook case of indie fear done right. I don't believe Visage is a total redemption arc. Most of the problems that drove me to cynicism with this game still linger in its bones. You're still gonna see some jump scares. The world is still structured in a maze-like way that's intimidating out of the gate. The puzzles are still pretty cryptic. But there's a reason why I continue to think about this game and what it represents as an indie horror title. Visage's house is something of a marvel, a way to make someplace grounded and believable into a ripe harvest of fear, a way to tell a story that's chilling in its solitude and anxious in its silence. It's a place that, despite what errors it might demonstrate, is difficult to fully depart. It begs to be explored, perused, examined from every angle. And that fear is the same kind that sticks in your mind and keeps you up at night. Bringing the otherworldly down to earth and making the real world just as terrifying, if not more, is something that the best of horror has accomplished time and time again. As the genre continues to change, I'm hoping that Visage remains in the conversation, because the potential for another revolution is upon us, as long as the right lessons are learned. And Visage has more to teach us about horror than I think many of us might know.